welcome. We are back here with the second of our campus face-offs, and we are coming this week from the wonderful city, the city that never sleeps, the city of Mumbai. We are here at the Sapphire Auditorium. Give yourselves a very big hand on the campus face-off. That's right, this unique show in the build-up to elections 2019 takes the battle of 2019 to the young of the country, gets India under 25 to ask their questions to the politicians, to ask their concerns to the politicians of the day. Let's then welcome our two big guests on the campus face-off here in Mumbai. Please welcome the two-time Member of Parliament from South Mumbai. He's been a former minister in the Union Government, Milind Deora of the Congress Party. And please welcome the Member of Parliament from Mumbai and the President of the BJP Yuva Morcha, Poonam Mahajan. So we have two young leaders to take the questions of young India. But before we start the show today, I'd like to observe a minute's silence for what's happened to our jawans in Pulwama in the Kashmir Valley. May I request all of you to stand up for a minute's silence. Thank you. As I said, this program against the backdrop of what's happened in Pulwama, let's then turn to you, the students, the young, the first-time voters here in Mumbai. I'm going to throw the floor to you. My first question is coming from a young man called Yash Dalal. Yash, what's your question? Come on the stage and ask your question.
My question to you, both the leaders, is, from Mumbai to Pulwama, we have seen multiple terror attacks. Every time the government talks about revenge, but nothing really happens. As young citizens, we really feel helpless. What are you going to do to change this situation?
Okay, who's going to take that first? Milind Deora, why don't you go first, since the last major terror attack in Mumbai took place in 2008 when it was your government in power.
Well, I think it's a very good question to ask, so thank you for that, firstly. And I think it's not a question that we should be asking in the wake of what happened in Pulwama. I think protecting our sovereignty, protecting our borders, protecting our cities is of utmost importance, even when terrorist attacks haven't happened. Unfortunately, when a terror attack happens, we all wake up as a society, the political class, the citizens, we demand accountability. But I think revenge is an emotion. Revenge is important, demonstrating to Pakistan and to countries that harbor terrorists, that encourage terrorists against us, is of extreme importance. I also think it's time for us to review some of our policies with regards to Pakistan more specifically, for instance. Now, I don't wish to politicize this debate, but unfortunately, there is a huge difference in policies between the Congress government and between the BJP government. Let me give you a small example. When we were in power for 10 years, and Dr. Manmohan Singh was Prime Minister of India from 2004 to 2014, Dr. Manmohan Singh had an ideological view in terms of his diplomatic view vis-a-vis Pakistan that he will never visit Pakistan as the Prime Minister because until the perpetrators of 26/11 are brought to justice. Also, we know that in Pakistan, you don't know who to talk to. Do you talk to the civilian government? Do you talk to the army? Unfortunately, in 2004, soon after Prime Minister Narendra Modi took over, one of the first decisive moves of his tenure before demonetization was to visit Pakistan, to wish Nawaz Sharif on his birthday, and to move away from a policy that had been adopted for 10 years, not just by Dr. Manmohan Singh actually, but it was a hangover from even Vajpayee Ji's policies. And I think when we talk of consistency in government, we talk of stability in government, I think in terms of a foreign policy vis-a-vis Pakistan, we need a consistent approach regardless of which party is in power.
Okay, your time is up. You've done your 2 minutes. Poonam Mahajan, respond. The suggestion being made by Milind Deora that I won't politicize it, but he's already politicized it. He's saying we were much better, we had a more consistent policy towards Pakistan than the BJP. Our Prime Minister Narendra Modi goes to Pakistan, hugs Nawaz Sharif one day, next day you have Pathankot, then you have Uri, now you have Pulwama.
As not making this issue as a political issue, I just want to say we are all are Indian citizens, though a citizen from Congress, from India Today or from BJP. We want our country to be safe. We want right policies for our country to be safe. Most important thing is, even with Atalji, he tried to make peace. Making peace is not a wrong idea, but just politicizing making that peace is not right. What happened in 2611, I was there in 2008. I saw what happened on 2611 and nothing happened after that. There are ministers in Congress government said chote chote, aise bade bade desh mein choti choti galtiyan hoti rehti hai. If you want to politicize, we can politicize this. But I request you and I request all of us to get together. As our Prime Minister today said that he's given, he wants to work on a comprehensive answer to this. From diplomatic relations to now he's given powers to army to take a call against Pakistan. That never ever happened in UPA government. So this is very important when our Prime Minister is concerned. He himself has today said that we will take all actions for our citizens, for our martyrs, and he's given all the powers to armies. Not like the other time when armies' heads were cut and not even returned back to India and UPA government.
I don't wish to, again, to make this a political debate, but I think his question as a young person, not just in Mumbai, but anywhere in the country. Look, the political rhetoric and the answer has to move beyond what is Congress versus BJP, the tutu meme. My limited point is there is a difference in policy. The difference in policy in the last 5 years has been very, very stark. Before the elections, there was a policy of a 56-inch chest. We will give it back to them.
Did we give it back in Uri?
Well, why then did they
give it back in Uri?
Well, why then did they move and move away from that?
Happened in 2611, Milind.
Poonam, why then did the government move away from that policy?
What policy?
And go and have the Prime Minister go and have biryani with Nawaz Sharif? That's something which the country wants to know.
First of all, what did he have? I don't know what you're discussing. But 2611 happened, and when your ministers could not say anything for that. What kind of diplomatic relations you're talking about?
You're talking about politicizing, Poonam. I was in 2611 in South Mumbai where it happened.
I was standing there too.
You know who came and politicized the entire attack on 2611? By the way, play the tapes, Rajdeep Sardesai in India Today. It was Prime Minister Narendra Modi.
He came in here and politicized the issue. Tried to help.
So look, let's not talk about who's politicizing the issue.
Away from this tutu meme, I'm asking this audience, do you want our politicians to fight terror as one or not?
Of course.
Right? Do you want them to argue about who has handled terror better or not?
No, sir.
No, but yes, it is true that that's the question that has been posed. Do you believe, as a young man, that you've got an answer or not?
I would not say completely satisfied, but...
Sort of. Okay, sort of satisfied. Okay, that's a start.
But the Prime Minister's given his answer is the satisfaction. Tomorrow, what Milind and I do, more important, our Prime Minister has promised to citizens of this country that I will give answer to this. And that is more important.
But is promise more... No, no, 1 minute, Poonam Mahajan. Is promises more important or is action more important?
Let's be honest. But see, so whether it is, you always believe in action more than words.
Whether it is Hafiz Saeed... Whether it is Hafiz Saeed when 2008 happened, whether it is Masood Azhar of the Jaish when Pulwama happens, the fact is the main perpetrators are in Pakistan and neither of you can do anything about it. That's the harsh reality. The perpetrators of Mumbai have still not been prosecuted. And I doubt whether the real people behind of the perpetrators of Pulwama will be prosecuted.
I request you not to doubt it when it's NDA government. It's my request to you.
I'm waiting to see Dawood Ibrahim back, ma'am. I'm waiting to see Dawood Ibrahim back in this country, Hafiz Saeed back, Masood Azhar back. All of you come and say, we will do it when you're in the opposition. What happens when you're in government?
But Rajdeep, if I can come in, look, let me answer his question as apolitically as possible. I think moving beyond Congress, BJP, policy A, policy B, I think it's important for us to move the debate even beyond what party A or party B is saying, and how do we as a country, how do we as law enforcement agencies build capacity to prevent such attacks? How do we build the intelligence capabilities to know when our perpetrator is, you know, thinking of these attacks? Number two, how do we as a country respond to these attacks? I think 26/11 was a wake-up call, not just for India, not just for the government in power, but for the world, that such an attack can happen. It never happened anywhere in the world. And I think a lot of lessons were learned by different governments, regardless of party A or B, after 26/11. So I think one thing that we must do as young people especially, and my appeal to all of you as students, is when you're debating terrorism and terror attacks in India, move the debate away from the rhetoric of BJP versus Congress. There is still a lot to be done, a lot of room beyond that. As I said, how do we improve our intelligence gathering capabilities? How do we improve our response time?
Is Mumbai today
those are critical issues.
Is Mumbai today a safer city?
I'll answer this question apolitically.
Milind, apolitically, this debate started when we talked about being Indian citizens. Then he politicized it. I gave an answer. But the answer from both of us is the same. We need to work on our policies, and the answers are coming.
Is Mumbai safer today?
Mumbai is safe.
Is Mumbai safer
today? I will say this, and I'm saying this in spite of the fact that there may be another party in power, and it's not. I'm not saying it's credit to party A or party B, but I think after 26/11, Rajdeep, my own experience, Mumbai's police, the coordination between the state government of Maharashtra, the central government, government of India, different law enforcement agencies, is far better after 2008 than it was pre-2008.
Okay, let's move
to the 26/11. I'm not saying a terrorist attack cannot happen, unfortunately. But I'm saying that the government, different governments, and not just Maharashtra, different state governments also, 26/11 was a huge wake-up call. Let me give you an example. There's something called a MACC, Multi-Agency Command Center. Now, after 26/11 and after 2008, and this was not implemented in the early part of UPA, this was not implemented in Vajpayee's NDA-1, but after 2008, different law enforcement agencies belonging to the central government, to state governments, share intelligence. They're more aware of things.
So basically, I would say, forward.
Basically, it required a terror attack for Mumbai to wake up. That's the tragedy in a sense of this city. Till then, we hadn't woken up. It required a terror attack. Is war an option? Is war really an option with a nuclear neighbor? There were a few people who raised their hands when I asked the question. Easy to go to war in a Bollywood movie.
I don't think
it's so. It's easy to go to war in a Bollywood movie in Uri and say, how's the Josh? The fact is, we need our host.
Making a mockery of a movie, which was actually giving a tribute to our jawans in Uri, is really in a bad taste. That's very important.
It's not about Josh and Hosh.
We all are standing here with Hosh.
You go to public rallies and say, how's the Josh? What about the jawan? What will you tell the poor jawans who have lost their lives?
Again, I'm saying, don't make the mockery of this. We all should stand by our jawans. Don't politicize this and put it on how's the Josh. We are all anguished. As diplomatic relations, everything, we have worked out on that way. What even UPA government worked out from 26/11, what they have done. Let's not politicize that. What as a nation, today we have to stand strongly, stand by the government, stand as Indian citizens and just, face it.
Yes, if I can add an option.
Look, the bottom line is this. Since 2014, over 400 jawans have been killed by terrorists, by cross-border terrorists. I'm being honest, I don't see a semblance of a clear, consistent policy on behalf of this government. I don't see a policy as in, do we want to go to war? Do we want to increase surgical strikes? Has been happening even in UPA's time, except a movie wasn't made, unfortunately, on it. But, or do we want to maintain peace? Or do we want to make impromptu, unplanned visits to wish the Prime Minister on his birthday? I think that that inconsistency in policy is sending a wrong signal to perpetrators of terrorism.
Policies are planned
have also been killed in the last year. Milind Deora, it's not just our Rajdeep, who are losing their life. We are also killing terrorists.
My limited point is this. Let me just complete. My limited point is this.
When it's Pakistan,
BJP is in power today. I would urge Poonam as an MP and an important MP in the party. The government should come out with a clear, consistent policy. I can assure you that the Congress party as an opposition will work with the government, will back the government. But all we're asking for is there should be a consistency in policy. If you have an inconsistent policy, enemies take advantage of that. That's my limited point.
You are ready. Rahul Gandhi is ready to sit across the table with Narendra Modi election season.
Yes, I'm certain of that. When it comes to national interest, Congress party will rise above party differences and will work with the government of the day. But the government of the day must show some semblance of a consistent policy. That is something which is missing. If you ask people today, you did a poll, how many people want to go to war, how many don't, there is an inconsistency in policy. The people of India are confused. Is the government for peace? Is the government going to be show a 56-inch chest? Show a clear policy, you will have opposition support on that.
Okay, that's a good positive thing to say there. But will the Prime Minister invite a Rahul Gandhi and the opposition leaders across the table and say, let's have a clear policy on how to deal with terror?
See, talking all the time about 56-inch, a two-piece train, it makes a lot of difference. Most importantly, the Prime Minister himself has said that we want every party, every member of every party to come together and take a call together with us, stand by our martyrs, stand by the country. All the time questioning and making a mockery of Uri or making a mockery of Prime Minister, it's not going to work out. Then we can question your party president that you should have hugged Prime Minister much before or just shown what kind of seriousness. Because
Poonam,
I sit in the parliament
serious,
and
let's
when he
serious.
Has to get up,
it's
no,
not
I'm
about,
seriously
it,
telling
it goes
you.
Beyond, look, no one's making a mockery of the movie. No one's, we are all interested in protecting our jawans.
Milind, so let's
we don't
take
want
forward.
More jawans to die. But my limited point, Poonam, just saying, people should come together, the
Milind,
Prime Minister said people should come
about
together.
56
you are in government.
Not going to help
the
you.
Foreign ministry, government of India is part of this government. Law enforcement agencies are part of this government. I am telling you as a policy maker, I am not seeing a consistent policy. I am being honest and constructive with you.
I think
come out with a consistent policy
is what?
You will have the opposition working together with the government. And that is the need of the hour.
Okay,
so you have to fight and you have to find peace. Or you just have to go on fighting. That's the question you're asking.
Again, it's for the government to come out with a policy, Poonam.
No,
it's the government.
The government
doesn't have a clear policy. What
do you believe? Do you believe that the government should go for surgical strikes part two?
See, what I believe is not important. Comprehensive decision has to be done. We have right people in the government who will be taking the decision, and I think by our finance minister Arun Jaitley, who's put in the idea forward that what we are going to do step by step, I think even Milind should see that.
Okay, let's then turn to the next question. What's your question?
Yeah, myself Divya Saya, I am from Patka College. We talk about that the strikes will be done and everything will be solved, but what about the integral parts? Itself in India, we are having so much issues with caste, religion and everything. So we are not, you know, like it is said that if internally we are fighting, then how can we be strong and, you know, we will be fighting with...
So you think that the real enemy is within, that we fight each other too much instead
see,
of fighting the enemy outside.
If I can come in, look.
Particularly the politicians, you fight each other and make every issue Congress versus BJP.
Now that's
the problem that the young have. And we in television, and dare I say, we in television encourage that. We in television encourage you to fight with each other. So given that, how will we ever be united against terror?
How will we be
united against Pakistan?
Let me answer a point, and I think it's a very important part of this terrorism debate. Look, when I say there are policy differences, today look at the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Today the state of Jammu and Kashmir is in turmoil. Why is Jammu and Kashmir in turmoil? Because of social policies of this government. It took us as a party a long time in our 10-year thing. I'm not saying we were perfect, but it took us a long time of having an inclusive approach which made Kashmiri youth feel that they are a part of India. Now, I want to ask you as young people a strategic question. Is it in our strategic interest that the youth of Jammu and Kashmir feel that they are an integral part of India or not?
Poonam Mahajan, in Mumbai, there have been cases where young Kashmiri students have been denied rent in housing. They are ostracized. They are said, you know, every stone pelter today is treated as a terrorist or a terrorist sympathizer. Every Kashmiri, even if he is not a stone pelter, is called a stone pelter and a terrorist. People in your government say that they are anti-national. If every Kashmiri has to wear a badge of patriotism, how are you going to convince them that their future lies in this country, ma'am?
No, I do not believe what Milind was trying to say about social policies. Social policy, which BJP always believe in, that Kashmir is integral part of India. Is Kashmir integral part of India or not? We should be fighting for Kashmir to be part of India or not. Your social policies have put all Kashmiri pundits, when you were in the government, out of Kashmir, thrown them on the roads. Do we remember that? We don't remember that. What we remember is about social policies. I, as a youth wing president, have gone to Jammu and Kashmir many times. connected with Kashmiri youth. So don't politicize about Kashmiri youth being liking by your social policy, our social policy. We want Kashmiri youth to be part of India. And they should be part of India because Kashmir is integral part of India. When that politics, you'll understand that Kashmir is integral part of India. I think a lot of social
but
issues
Poonam,
will
unfortunately, policies of this government have moved are slowly but steadily distancing Kashmiri youth from India. And I'm just saying, I'm making a point that when you have policies like that, you're essentially creating a breeding ground for radical elements.
I think today's word is policy. What policy is that? I'm not understanding. You just want to question social policies, government
policies. Can I ask you a simple question, Poonam ji? If a young Kashmiri comes to Mumbai, is denied housing, will you and the BJP Yuva Morcha stand up for him or
me
not?
And the BJP,
will you all come out and say, ki usko ghar dena hai, he's an Indian? Or will you say, wo anti-national hai?
Sir, I don't know what kind of examples you're using, that's why questioning me. But I, as a BJP member of parliament, youth wing president, Indian national Mumbai kar, will always welcome Kashmiri youth, Assamia youth, Nagalandi youth, South Indian youth, any youth coming in Mumbai, because Mumbai is the city for everyone. And I think even Milind will support it. I mean, there is nothing politicizing.
I just feel, Poonam, unfortunately, when your ministers, when union ministers in the government of India, part of your party, make statements that if you belong to a certain community, go to Pakistan, when you make those kind of statements, what happens? Listen to me. When there are many ministers, when they make those statements, what you're doing is, you're making people feel excluded. All I'm trying to tell you is the politics of exclusion is not in India's national interest. It's not in India's national security.
Didn't I give the inclusion plan of India and BJP, how BJP looks forward to it? And what a minister says and what your minister says is not the conversation here.
It's not what you're saying, but it's something when a union minister makes statements like that and they're not reprimanded, it's a very serious issue in my opinion.
Okay, let's come to the next question. Akanksha Malia.
My question is for both of you. Hypernationalism, communalism, growth of violence, and an inflammatory rhetoric were on a rise post 2014, as we all have observed. Do you think that these factors will govern the 2019 election results also?
Who wants to take that? Who's going to tell the young of India that we will not seek for votes on the ground of religion or caste? We will seek for votes on development. This young India wants votes not on the basis of caste and religion.
Question is quite interesting and a very good question. You spoke about hyper-nationalism, but you did not understand how the hyper-anti-nationalism is also working in this country. You cannot be in the college, have all freedom of expression, saying Bharat ke tukde honge hazar, inshallah, inshallah. You should stand by the government. Stand by the government is not important. Stand by your own nation. You're a youth of this country. You're going to be deciding that what this country is going to do. 15 crore first-time voters will be voting in 2019 and deciding their future with country's future and how they are going to be connected. So caste, religion, I don't think this is our agenda. As Mr. Sardesai has only said, Vikas, development to every corner of this country and to every youth, that is the agenda we are looking for. Hyper-nationalism, hyper-anti-nationalism should not be an agenda for any election. Yes, if you're a patriot, that should be the agenda of the election.
You're saying this here, but I must ask both of you, when you choose candidates, do you choose them on the grounds of their religion or caste or on the basis of Vikas?
I think in Mumbai,
let's be clear. In Mumbai, are we very clear that in Mumbai, the politics are not Maharashtrian versus North Indian? Milind Deora, why don't you answer that? Your party is caught in that. Are you playing North Indian politics? Are you going to play the politics of Maharashtrian? What is your politics?
We've never played that politics. We've never aligned with parties like Shiv Sena or MNS, and we will not. I'll make that statement here.
You will not align with the MNS?
We will not.
Raj Thackeray is tying up with the NCP.
With
who's
parties,
your ally?
We will never align with parties who believe in sectarianism, who divide people on language they speak, on other things. But let me answer her question directly. I feel it's very sad, and I say this as someone who's been in politics for 15 years, that today, after 5 years of this government, who promised the world to the people of India, that the primary issue in this country is whether a temple or a masjid should be built. I believe, why aren't we debating education and healthcare instead? Why aren't we debating women's safety and jobs instead? And I really believe, and I say this across the board in every college I interact with and with every student I interact with, it's not enough for the three of us on this panel to be determining that issue. Rajdeep as a media professional, Poonam and I as politicians. The power rests in your hands. If you as students, whatever you may be studying, if you are concerned about your future, If you are concerned about the quality of your education, the quality of your healthcare, the potential, the prospect of getting a job when you graduate from college, you have to move the discourse away from these issues. And I have faith that the citizens and the voters and the youth of Mumbai will do that. If you punish parties who fight elections on temple or mosque and move issues, as I said, towards education and healthcare, that move issues towards jobs and women's safety, you will get the government you deserve.
You want to respond to that? That he's virtually suggesting your party wants votes on Mandir Mosque, not on health and education.
So he's questioning the idea and, you know, brilliance of 2014, the people who voted for BJP. Are you questioning their actual intent voting for BJP?
Poonam, I'm questioning. Thank you for asking me that question. I'm questioning the fact that a government in 2014, and where the Prime Minister promised the people of India development, I'm questioning what have you done so great in the last 5 years that today on the eve of elections, all you're talking about is Mandir versus Masjid. Why aren't you talking to the youth about jobs? Why aren't you talking to the youth about women's safety? Why aren't you talking to the youth about colleges and about education? Why aren't you talking to them about public health care?
Isn't the Prime Minister actually not talking? He's walking the talk. Talking is always.
I don't know.
Is the government talking about Mandir versus Masjid?
When you're talking about doing development work for people
from all stratas, I think you can see the maximum bills passed to support what the government should be doing, what should be reaching out to people, people in urban area, people in rural area, urban area, our farmers, our youth. What has not been done? It's a start. I won't say it's been done, but at least there is a start, which is a very clear start for people of this India who had faith and still have faith in BJP and NDA government. This is what we are looking out for.
Poonam Mahajan, what is the more important issue for you and your party? Whether a Ram Mandir is built in Ayodhya or whether more young Indians are provided jobs?
Development. It includes the jobs. It includes right roads. It includes no corruption. It includes my farmers getting proper MSP prices. This is what it includes, and development, Vikas, this is what we are looking forward for.
Okay, so you're saying very clearly that
yes,
your primary issue is health and education, and Milind Deora is unnecessarily trying to bring in the Mandir Masjid issue. Am I correct?
Because that helps him. Divide and rule has been Congress's
I'm surprised that Poonam is saying. I'm surprised that Poonam is saying Milind Deora is trying to bring in this issue.
I'm saying Congress.
When
that
the
Mr.
Prime
Sardesai
Minister, the party president of the BJP, all I ever hear from them is Mandir Masjid, Mandir Masjid.
Okay, the next question, this girl has a question here. What's your name, ma'am?
My name is Vishwa Pai. My question is, especially to the Congress, I'm so sorry, but it's like, if we think that the head is not that intelligent enough to take care of all the things which you promised, especially the education part, how do we believe you and how do we actually think about believing what you have promised will be accomplished?
She seems to suggest that Rahul Gandhi, according to her, is less intelligent than Narendra Modi.
Exactly.
That's your view.
Look, in my view, and bear with me for a second, I'll tell you what my view on this is and talking about politics in general. I think we as a citizenry and we as voters, whether it's in India, whether it's in the United States, perhaps the media has some role in that, we've started focusing much more on personalities than on issues. Today, for instance, we talk of Narendra Modi ji versus Rahul Gandhi, and we say Narendra Modi ji is a decisive leader. That's something I hear a lot. He's a decisive leader. My response is, when he broke away from Dr. Manmohan Singh and Atal Bihari Vajpayee's policy with regards to Pakistan, one sec, Rajdeep, and said, I'm going to wish Nawaz Sharif on his birthday, very impromptu, very suddenly, was it decisive? Absolutely. When he said, I'm going to demonetize 86% of India's currency, in spite of the Reserve Bank of India saying no, advising against it, was it decisive? Absolutely. But why are we as a society, and why do you as young people, not focus on the decision? Decisiveness is a personality trait, but the decision is the issue. So I think we have, unfortunately, and to credit to the BJP and to Narendra Modi ji, they have spent a huge amount of resources in trying to destroy Rahul Gandhi's reputation. But I can assure you today, the youth of India want change. The youth of India are able to understand that there is a huge difference between personality and between issues. And I can assure you that the young people of India, of Mumbai, of your college, of different colleges, will vote on issues that affect them.
No,
because
no,
personality versus issue
Your time is up. Mandir, your time is up. You're saying there's a difference between the between being decisive and taking the right decision.
I want to make a quick comment,
particularly on demonetization. A lot of young people have been sending me questions on Twitter saying, please ask Poonam Mahajan, what benefit did demonetization give this country at the end?
They want to finally ask that question.
They want to know what happened. It was a decisive decision, but it caused so much of suffering to so many people.
Don't divert your question. She asked another question, which I want to answer, which even Milind Deora answered.
I'm asking
you
both. I asked him that.
You can ask
I'm
me four questions
this.
Also. That's not a problem. But Mr. Sardesai, let me answer that. What she was saying, and I don't want to say anything more than that, we actually respect Rahul Gandhi, is our the strongest asset for victory of BJP. So we don't want him to go anywhere. That's point number one. When you're talking about personalities, when you're talking about personalities, it is a personality fight which we have seen it with Gandhi family since we have got our independence. It is fight for Nehru, it is fight for Indira Gandhi ji, it is fight for Rajiv Gandhi, it is fight for Rahul Gandhi, then Rahul Gandhi's mother, and now supporting by his sister. That's not a personality cult you're thinking about.
Okay, it's very
so
interesting. It's very interesting that the two of you would refer to dynasty since you're also the daughter of a famous politician and he's the son of a famous politician. So you two are part of the same dynasty
but
syndrome.
Rajdeep sir, Rajdeep sir. I never contested my father's constituency. It's been 12 years for me in the party. I started from Maharashtra. I did not say, oh, my father's Rajya Sabha seat is left for me, so please give it to me. Oh, I need that space where my father's vacated. No. My party does not believe in this, and I have also come here with my own strength, with my own hard work and support of the
people. Okay, let's come to the next question.
How do you expect votes from the youth when the employment rate is lowest ever?
How many of you in this audience are worried about your future in terms of jobs? Give an honest answer. Look at that. That's 95-99%. Both of you, this is the real issue of our times. What are you doing? Milind Deora, they could well turn around and say you
I think me and Milind can also take our hands up when in politics, always worried about your job.
Okay, you're also worried about your job, but I want to ask you, this is the real issue that is facing the young. They're worried about their future.
See, I think Poonam raised an important point. Things were difficult for the economy in 2014. Please understand, we had a regime and we had massive headwinds where we had $120 a barrel of oil. India still imports a lot of oil for its energy needs. But Poonam made a point that there was a large cash economy in 2014 when the government took power. There was agrarian distress, there was unemployment. Today, I'd like to tell Poonam that 5 years later, there's more cash in the economy than there was in 2014 after demonetization. There's more agrarian distress and there's much more unemployment. Coming back to the point on demonetization, since essentially
so how would you
she
provide
was trying
job?
To...
No, how would you provide job? Let's be very clear. It's very easy to be in the opposition and attack the government.
I'll tell you. I think firstly a sector, if you look at what is happening in the agrarian economy, we talk of demonetization, Rajdeep, as impacting people in cities, and with due respect to all of you college students from Mumbai. The biggest, most negative impact of demonetization has been on farmers. Do you think farmers are using Paytm? Do you think farmers have Paytm accounts on their mobile phones and they're transacting with that, as the government would make you believe? One second. That is a serious hit on jobs. Why is that a hit on jobs? When a farmer feels, I have no future in the rural sector, he or she is forced to migrate from a rural area to a city. That puts further strain on the unemployment problem in India. Let me tell you about another sector. Real estate sector today. Real estate and construction is one of the largest employers in our country. You know what has happened to the real estate sector? Demonetization, RERA, which I support, a very faultily implemented GST, it's destroyed the real estate sector. What happens when you destroy the sector like real estate? Not only does real estate have a direct impact in providing jobs, but don't forget when you construct a building, you're building that building with cement, with steel. It also has an impact on ancillary industries like cement and steel.
Your time is up. My limited point is, and I make this point.
I repeat my point. Unfortunately, demonetization.
Your time is up.
So when you talk about ancillary, when you talk about cement, when you talk about steel,
You know we are the second largest automobile industry in the world.
Poonam,
you know we are the second largest mobile
making. I was a minister of communications and IT, and the policy of encouraging electronics manufacturing in India was initiated by me.
So making policy and implementing is the problem in Congress.
Implementing it. No, it's not.
Talking about, that's what I'm saying. Walk the talk is more important. You're talking about agrarian crisis. Where is the number where farmers are coming towards city?
Okay, Poonam, I have one question to you about formalizing economy. One question which nobody in BJP and nobody in government and no economist has answered. If one of the aims of demonetization was to reduce the supply of black money in our economy, can you please tell me and this audience why the government scrapped the 1,000 rupee note and brought a 2,000 rupee note?
My only answer to Milind is, when there is a decisiveness in the government, when the policy has been spoken for,
again,
and the policies has been
not the decision. Decisiveness is the distraction.
Okay, okay.
So that's the what your distraction.
Well, and you must let an answer.
So,
why did you bring that 2,000 rupee note? Is the question he's asking. You're not answering it.
I think the
basically black pink is the new black is what he's trying to say. Go ahead.
Where the answer is not given by Milind, not by economist, and not by the government, I'll just give you an answer. When there is a decision taken for 2,000 rupees note, there is a decision taken for a real reason. I don't know how you have an answer. There is more cash in the system than before. I think that must be helping you a lot for your elections. I really have no idea. I mean, I don't see it very much.
Again, Poonam, you haven't answered the question.
Basically, she's
the
saying,
fact of the
she's
matter
saying
is,
the counten, Congress is the original fountainhead of the cash economy. That's what she's trying to suggest. Okay, let's move on. An important question from Ashish Soni on Twitter. He says, lack of affordable housing, pothole-ridden roads, traffic jams. These are the real issues of Mumbai. Why don't you talk about them during elections? Who's going to answer that? Mumbai's infrastructure. Who's better, you or you?
I'm happy to answer that question. And I'll tell you, I'll give you an example. Rajdeep, sometime back, one of Poonam's allies, the Shiv Sena corporator from Malabar Hill, mind you, made a statement that we should rename Malabar Hill to Ramnagari. And someone asked me, Milind, what's your view on that? By the way, this is Malabar Hill. This is where we are now. And they said, what's your view on that? And I said, if renaming Malabar Hill to Ramnagari means there'll be no potholes on the roads, every building and every resident will have access to water, I'm all for it. Unfortunately, whoever asked that question, they're right. These are the issues we should be debating in an election. As I said, moving away from the emotional issues of decisiveness, personalities, Mandir versus Masjid, if we focus on urban development, education, healthcare, jobs, women's safety, these are the issues that impact every citizen every day.
Okay, let her respond to that. Urban infrastructure, do you believe it should be the main election issue in a city like Mumbai?
Very much, because I'm part of the CM's ward room, which works on each and every infrastructure project happens in Mumbai and Maharashtra. You have seen, yes, we do have traffic issues, but we do have nagging traffic issue for a reason. We are getting 7 metros in Mumbai in a record time to show it to Mumbaikar that we believe in public transport. That what MTHL, which was stuck in Congress government for 30 years, where we can connect the main line to Navi Mumbai, the MTHL will be happening in 3 years.
BJP
Navi Mumbai Airport will be coming in 2019 end. These are the infrastructural issues we are just not talking about for past 30 years. We are implementing it. Whatever BJP government and its ministry has that strength and that capacity to do it, I think we are overdoing it and we are trying to implement it and trying to show that Mumbaikar, their life has to be at ease, and public transport, which is the most important issue pertaining all the time for Mumbaikars, which all of us have used it. Public transport issue has been tackled very strongly by the government.
Okay,
but I agree that public transportation in a city like Mumbai is of far more importance than what we're doing with roads and motorists.
Okay, I have another question.
My name is Siddharth Desai and I'm from SCM Sofia.
What's your question?
So I think this question is second most important to the jobs question for the youth. So I know alcohol industry and the tobacco industry is a big fund for the political parties and elections. But I want to ask, what is the party's stand on legalization of marijuana?
Very. I'm not going to ask you whether you smoke it. I hope you don't.
Once it's legal, if it gets legalized, you can answer that question.
What's your stand?
I don't think.
Because you're a part-time rocker with your guitar, so I presume that sticking to that image.
What is that?
Because Canada has just legalized it.
I'll tell you my view, and I don't think there is a party view. I don't think my party has a view yet. It's in the last 30 years that you realize that smoking cigarettes is harmful for you. It causes cancer. 20, 30 years ago, everyone said marijuana has only negative effects. Today, there is science and there is research saying that marijuana could have positive effects. It's allowed in some states in America, like California, for treating arthritis, for treating other ailments. So I think that the jury is out. I have an open mind to it. I think that if there are medicinal benefits, there is conclusive evidence. I see no reason why it should not be controlled and legalized.
And you really think, young man, it's the second most important issue after jobs, right? You really think that legalizing marijuana is the second most important issue?
But one interesting point.
Because everything else is... Listen, everything else is so expensive. That's the.
But you know, in.
I see, okay. Everything else is so expensive.
But if I don't have a job, that's my last resort.
It's a very interesting point to sort of correlate
it to
jobs.
I hope your parents are not watching you on TV.
I can see, 1 minute.
They don't mind.
I can see, of course, Poonam Mahajan, being a good BJP leader, but is Rajdeep, not even commenting on marijuana at the moment.
It didn't come to me, thank God.
Yes.
But interestingly, I have a teenage son, and when I look at you, it just scares me. And he does look like you a bit.
Ma'am, you should check
her
phone.
Well done to you.
You should check her phone. Check his phone.
Or his pockets. Yeah.
You should check his phone or his pockets. Okay, he's warned you there. Okay, one more question.
You know, one point,
alcohol industry and tobacco industry is supporting any political party, and they should not. I don't know what kind of open mind I have, but my open mind is for medicinal uses. Many countries have used it, and I think even India should look forward to it for medicinal purposes.
But in America,
good
the
to see
fastest
politicians opening up their minds more and more. Yes.
My question is related to the Jammu and Kashmir conflict, which has been going on for years now, right? And people are being killed on everyday basis. Those who live there are neither free nor safe. What is the best political solution to that? What do we do about it?
Okay, go ahead. You know, at the end of the day, governments come and go. Two generations of Kashmiris have seen nothing but violence. We started this program talking about Pulwama. Let's try and end talking about it again. Can you give me an assurance, Poonam Mahajan? Can anyone give an assurance that the Prime Minister will make Jammu and Kashmir peace one of his top priorities?
More than giving an assurance, I want to assure everyone, any government sitting there taking the decision for country's citizens will always make a decision to keep their country safe. Let's not politicize this, which I even want to tell Milind. Let's not turn and twist the topic from here. But most importantly, what has happened to us and what is happening to Jammu and Kashmir for many, many years? Let's get into policies, what happened, policy paralysis, division in vote, division in, you know, political thinking of Hindu or Muslims, Kashmiri pundits. They were all Kashmiri citizens. And Kashmiri citizens, the young Kashmiri, should have faith in us. And it's our responsibility.
Do you have faith in them?
I said Kashmir is an integral part of India. And it's our duty to make them believe.
Kashmiri people, not just the land. The people. Are the people an integral part of India? It's
I
not
feel
just
Maharashtra
about
is
it's
part of
people.
India. Does that mean Maharashtrian people are not there? It's just the land I'm talking about.
I'm asking you whether the Kashmiri
regard
and respect.
Kashmir and people of Kashmir both mean the same to us.
Okay,
it's not divided into some political numbering.
Good.
We
good
want
to hear
to
that.
Part
one,
of India.
One last question.
Every time that I watch TV, I just see Ram Mandir or Babri Masjid. There's no employment, all that discussion. So today when I was traveling here, so there was right after any terrorist attack, anything happens. Why is it that Muslims are cornered?
You because feel victimized.
Yeah, we feel victimized because it's like we feel cornered, we feel insecure. When I go anywhere, this is questioned. Why am I wearing a hijab? Such things are questioned.
She is basically asking a very important question, ma'am. A question that we sometimes don't ask often enough.
Yeah.
Is she, as a young Indian, entitled to wear her dress the way she wants, be who she wants, eat what she wants, go and meet who she wants, marry who she wants? Is she going to be branded? Today we live in a society, ma'am, you know what's happened in Kerala. There are questions raised when a young Hindu girl marries a Muslim boy. She wants to know, is she free as an Indian or not? Or will you see the hijab and say, is she anti-national? Is that right or not?
Yeah, right.
Sadly, the question comes to me because... Aisha, I understood your question, and you look lovely in your hijab. So
you.
I
very
don't
good.
Understand
well
where is
said.
The thing
well
to talk about. Let me put it with me. Let's not talk about the national politics. I come from a constituency where people always believed
people from Congress party always believe that I cannot win this constituency because there are more number of minorities voting in my constituency than majority. I prove them wrong to show that every voter, instead Muslim, Hindu, it doesn't matter, because constitution has given you that right to wear what you want, to say what you want, to eat what you want. So you cannot question me. This is a typical narrative set that BJP has to be questioned for that. No, I won from a constituency where this narrative was set. And I won with a very big margin.
Poonam Mahajan,
and people supported me.
You've spoken very well about it. Can you ensure that your politicians in Uttar Pradesh and other states also think like you?
My request to you is,
it would certainly help. Okay, let me...
Showing some low-end person who might be remotely somewhere talking about BJP, might not be part of BJP, stop showing them on your channel for TRP rating and show right people like me on your channel.
Okay,
which
good.
Will
good
be
answer.
Helpful. Stop that's all this.
She's saying stop showing Amit Shah on your channel, basically.
Okay, that's
right. That's
okay.
Too derogatory. Then we'll talk about 56 inch and 2 gram piece bill.
I said she's basically telling you not to show Amit Shah on your channel.
Now that's basically a hit bill. Okay, let me conclude. Let me conclude by asking both of you a relatively softer question, which seems to be coming from Shardul Tikone. Is Shardul here?
What is the hardest part of being in politics?
That's a good question to both of you to end. What is the hardest part of being in politics? You go first.
I was in South Mumbai. I thought all colleges are from South Mumbai. One from my constituency, one college person has come. Thank you very much. Hardest part in politics, I think you can see it. Let me put it this way. Sometimes I feel I'm fortunate to be here. God has given me this opportunity. I have got this opportunity from people. How many people get an opportunity to help others? Very few. And we want to pay it forward. I think we've got bigger opportunity to make policy for this nation, the nation which is thriving.
What's the hardest part?
Hardest part? I don't take anything as a hardest part. By night, I'm really frustrated that sometimes it's a thankless job, sometimes it's a wonderful job. Morning, I'm perfectly all right to fight it again. I think that's in my DNA.
Oh, very good. Okay, good. So you wake up every morning saying, "Fir subah hogi." Milind Deora, what's the hardest part of being in politics? That you can't do your music anymore?
I was going to say that, yes. For me, I think personally, the hardest part is I think politics is a full-time job. Politics is not a 9-to-5 job. Especially like Poonam and me, if you're in electoral politics, there's no time limit to when your day ends and when your day really begins. Morning you start, you finish in the evening, you have very little time for yourself, very little time for your family. But I agree with Poonam's point that for once we agree on something, that for both of us, you know, we're really young. I got the opportunity to become a member of parliament at the age of 27. Very few people do that. I'm grateful for the fact that I had a family background in politics. I was able to do that. And although it is frustrating, although people have very high expectations from politicians, I think people have even higher expectations from younger politicians. The fact that you're able to change somebody's life through your policies, through your ideas, through your actions, that I think is very, very fulfilling.
Okay, well, we hope that both of you will at least change Mumbai. We hope that both of you will be elected, because we want more young people in parliament as always. And I want to ask this audience, how many people in this audience want to enter politics?
You have my email ID. All are welcome in BJP Yuva Morcha.
But my message to you is, regardless of which party you choose, the most important thing for you is vote and vote wisely. And when I say vote wisely, move away from emotional issues.
You don't want to give an email ID like
her. I'm happy to give you my email ID, my Twitter ID, my Facebook ID, all my IDs.
So you can choose whether you want to join the Congress or the BJP. At the end of the day, it's for the young of this wonderful city, of this great country, to decide who they will choose in 2019. Thank you all, Mumbaikers. Give them both a very big hand on the campus face-off.
Thanks for watching the video. For more such news and updates, please like, share and subscribe to India Today. Also, check out our other great videos from our channel, We Know You Will Love To.